starring Flippo the Clown with his orchestra. We call it the Flippo Special Program, starring Flippo the Clown with his orchestra.
You never knew whether Flippo really appealed to grown-ups or children in Columbus. He was certainly one of the biggest celebrities in town. I think it was Flippo and Woody Hayes in that order, or one order or the other.
You can't look at the guy as just a clown. I mean, the fact that he wore makeup and the fact that he wore a clown suit doesn't explain his full range of talent.
An incredible talent, a very funny, sweet man that affected everybody's life.
Tuning into Channel 10 and seeing this man who looked like a circus clown, but there was nothing circus-like about his behavior. There was a hip edginess and a touch of Catskills to his comedy.
Flippo was my babysitter. Long before MTV, long before chat rooms and the internet for after-school fun, there was the F-man, Flippo.
Wait a minute. That's nowhere to be. Cut them. Barry, your beard's on fire. Oh, no, that's a pipe. Huh? Don't step on the banana. There you go. Well, I'm back anyway. I see you, Al. What, you didn't have lunch? Al can't hear me. He's got a banana stuck in his ear.
Lady here in front couldn't clap her hands, has two children on her lap, so she's clapping the two kids together. Bam, bam, bam. You ought to see the kids.
Now let's get along to a program that's not so educational, but mighty highly rated kid entertainment. It's Flippo and Comedy Theater. Let's watch Flippo, Oh, the Day Captain Kangaroo Came to Call.
Isn't that wonderful?
I thought I'd deliver this letter personally.
Oh, thank you very much. I'm expecting a letter from Captain Kangaroo, you
know. Well, yeah, I could have given it to the mailman, but I thought I'd deliver it personally.
Is that a regulation uniform you're wearing?
Well, yes, you see, I rather...
You look like I've seen you somewhere.
Well, yes, you see, what I wanted to explain...
Let's read the letter.
Yeah, I think if you read that, it'll explain everything to you.
I can read, you know.
Oh, can you?
Yes.
Good.
It says, "Hi, Flip. Be sure to remind the boys and girls to see my show at 8:15 on Channel 10 and Saturdays at 8 a.m. too. Now the mailman has a surprise.
You've got the captain.
You got the captain with you. Yeah. Oh, it's a lovely hairdo. Where's the captain?
No.
Where
no, but you don't
understand.
You got
the captain with you. I know you have.
No, but you see, Flip.
Captain.
Look, maybe if I took the
bag. He's in here.
No,
He's not there.
No. No, what I want, I'll put the hat.
I'll just
stand here like this, and maybe you'll understand.
Don't just stand there. Go out and get him. He must be in the car.
See, no, but you don't understand something.
You got a mail truck?
No, it's neither the mail truck.
I want to see the captain.
You want me to go out?
Go and get the captain. Go!
Well, all right, Flippo. Just forget the whole thing. All right. Thanks anyway.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Mailman.
Couldn't make him understand. You see, with him, the door opens only one way, and he didn't understand.
I know. I've seen him somewhere before.
See, we're going to have all kinds of unusual things here on Flippo's Magic Circus, not the least of which is a clown. How old is Elsa?
Elsa's 4 months old.
4 months old. What does Elsa eat besides clowns?
Which one's next, Charlie? And now here's a word from our sponsor.
Little boy, where are you going to that revolving door? I'm looking for my daddy. Who's your daddy? Luke McLuke. I'm Luke McLuke. Daddy, son. I've always been wanting to do that.
Whatever happened to Art Matrano, the serious actor? Needless to say, you've been on laughing.
Yes. Why is your nose so red?
Huh? It's not a nose, it's a wart.
Oh,
I painted it.
Very cute.
I got started in showbiz.
Looks like a Chinese
ping
pong.
Tell us about the series. What's about the series?
Oh, the series.
Tell us about the series.
It's a new show.
This guy.
Yeah, he's very
cute. You wear a tie in that?
Very nice tie. A-R-L-M-R-J-F-C-F.
The word is Gazenzel.
Gazenzel.
Come on.
Hi, nice to see you.
This is a hand mic.
Oh, I thought it was a Q-tip.
No, it's it's the only authentic hand mic
in
broadcasting.
Really, very nice. I like that. Going my way?
It bothers me.
As if you don't have enough.
Hey, right. Hey, leave me alone. They keep doing this here in Ohio. What does this all mean?
Well, you see, we just had a tough winter.
Tough winter and no undie-on deodorant, so they do this.
No,
hey, did you catch that, guys?
It's not that. We're short of energy.
I see.
And when he does this, it powers the windmill, and it makes the whole thing, and the gerbil gets excited, runs in the cage, and we got a picture.
And he keeps doing that.
Art, thank
pleasure.
You for coming by. I know you got to go catch an airplane or whatever, and come back often.
I will.
I'll be here anytime.
Thank you.
Art Matrano, ladies and gentlemen.
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-
Okay. You turkeys come in here and you go to sleep. You've been hanging out with... You've been hanging out with Crash. The whole outfit. You get a feeling this interview is not getting off the ground? Did you guys leave a wake-up call? It's time.
Is it time?
4:20. You're supposed to wake up.
Are you ready?
Hi, away. Brett.
Is that a wake-up call on my room?
I got
number?
It. Huh? Is it 3D? Oh, look. There you are.
Hello.
Hello. You tell me your dream. We're not going to do that?
No.
We rehearsed it.
We're supposed to do... Here he comes, here he comes, here he C-O-M-E-S, I must confess, that I'm all thumbs, here he hears it, here he comes, here he comes, come now, yeah, oh, we made it very clear, he's here.
And I want to see these guys didn't even got a bass tone, nothing, you just do that off the top of your, somebody have perfect pitch?
Huh?
What'd you say? Huh?
Now pay attention, all you girls. I had a chick, see? About 6 feet two. She never thought a little old midget like me would do.
Yeah.
One day she took up with some other cat. He took all the money and he left her flat. Yeah. She's calling me up on the phone. She said, baby, come on home. I'm all alone, yeah. But if I'm going back to her grand shack, she got to hug me in the morning, kiss me every night. I give me plenty of love, treat me right. Now, it's a good night. Nowadays is hard to find. Yeah, baby!
Is that okay? Hey! Okay, you guys, back up against that wall. And you gotta watch it, because I got an itchy, tricky thingy. That's not the way that goes. You guys are at the Vets Memorial.
Yes. Yeah. Doing Godspell.
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 Godspell. And, geez, all I keep wanting to do is go to the barbershop.
Barbershop.
Barbershop. Barbershop. Oh. Nobody gave me the cutoff.
No, sorry. I'll cut you off.
I'll get you.
Put your wife's in.
Brett?
Yes.
Hi.
Hi.
This is Brett Hudson, and Bill's over there. Bill?
Here.
There's
Hi.
Bill.
Oh, yeah.
And this is?
Mark.
Mark. How do you do? And we're very happy that you could come visit us today.
I'm glad we're here.
Yeah, you're nuts. But,
yeah, I watched your show.
You're crazy.
It's really,
we
folks,
want to steal his material.
No, I got to tell you, for the folks at home, you might think he's just a normal human behind this costume. Wrong.
This is not a costume.
No toys in the attic for Flippo.
El Flippo.
There is a plane missing.
You got no light at the top of the stairs.
I've been accused of running on empty. Anybody said that?
We finally found our dad.
Everybody said
all these years. Hey, Rob McEwen's been looking.
Here's Bubble! Oh. Yeah!
All right, you know who that is.
You dip on the first date. Sure, I know who that is. Sam Butera.
No, that's Bernice.
She looks a lot like Sam Butera. Maybe she ought to shave.
She's kind of shaky.
Would you give me a prognostication about TV?
I will not only do that, I will take a wild guess at the future. I predict a combination of medical shows and detective shows. For instance, 1964 will show us a show entitled Hawaiian Eye, Ear, Nose, and Throat. I predict that show.
Starring Dr. Ben Kildare.
Stop looking in the ball. I'll do the funny stuff.
Oh, sir?
Yes.
I need a pair of bowling shoes.
Oh, okay. What size?
A 90. 90. No, 90.
90, there you go.
Oh, nice. They match my outfit. Oh,
what a coincidence.
You've been bringing joy to millions for a quarter of a century. And tonight, hopefully, we can do the same for you, because Flippo, here is your life!
Some girls grow up dreaming of leading men like Clark Gable or Paul Newman, but my dream came true when my leading man was Flippo.
Lovely comedian and your co-star in Vignette, Diane Disk.
Hi there. You know something? You can't get any hugging done with this makeup on. That's why Mrs. Flippo never worries about how good-looking the girls are at work. We got a whole bunch of good-looking girls at work, and she doesn't worry about a thing.
I want to know how you picked him as your ideal leading man.
Oh, well, when I was a little girl in the Brownies, we went to the studio one day, and I had pigtails, and he picked up my pigtail, and he said I could be a painter someday because I had, you know, use them for...
Build-in brushes, right?
Right, and I never forgot it, the touch of the clown, and so I wanted to go into show business ever since he touched me.
touch
me in the morning.
We can use you both on cube heads.
We'll be back a little bit later. Wait a minute. They
all right, a minute.
Thing
stick
on
with
here,
us a little
stay.
Bit. We just happen to have something I think you'd want to see.
Yeah.
A film clip of one of your romantic scenes.
Charlie, if you would only spend one day with me and the kids, just one day instead of out here on this lousy golf course, I think I could drop dead.
Listen, Edna, it'll do you no good to try and bribe me. Stand back.
No one starts out in life to become a TV clown. Young Marvin Fishman had no idea that he would become Jazzy Bob Marvin, who had no idea that he would become Flippo, King of the Clowns.
How did I become a clown? I didn't know anybody that was a clown. I didn't get influenced to be a clown. I just happened to be standing there. Anybody here know how to use makeup? I do, but then they cleaned up that part of Cleveland. He said, you, come here. That's what started it all. Opening my mouth, and I ended up in makeup for 30 years. He would say, what do you dress up, how do you dress up on Halloween? I said, I put on a suit and make like I'm Joe Holbrook. It's January 6th, 1927, Mount Sinai Hospital. And all of a sudden, throughout the halls, we heard, that was me. Mrs. Fishman gave birth to Marvin. And it happened there in Cleveland because I wanted to be close to my mother. I hate to even say this, but I was so ugly that the doctor slapped my mother. When I was born, the doctor smacked me, bam. Instead of screaming and yelling, I went, wah! He said, uh-oh, the kid's got talent. It was practically that young when I started singing. I was 4, 5 maybe, and I was gifted with a really nice singing voice. And I sang at all the school functions, and I ended up taking singing lessons at the Billy Tilton School of Music. They liked my voice enough that they asked me to open their radio show every Saturday. I would sing, tap, tap, tap,
those dancing feet. But there'd be another kid over on a piece of masonite tap dancing, privately connecting. And my friends, the gang, Pinky and Yussel and Finger and Chip Ear, they all thought I was dancing and singing at the same time. And they'd ask me, how can you do that, man? How can you dance and sing at the same time? Don't you run out of breath? And I said, well, you gotta learn how to get breath control. I wasn't about to tell them.
We're in Cleveland, Ohio.
A mistake on the lake.
Here's my old street, folks. I used to live here. Used to be Hungarians, Italians, Slavics. That's my house right there. That house was originally bought for around, well, we sold it, I believe, for around $7,000, $7,500. Now who knows what it's worth. I have no idea. Moving right along, folks. Kensington Park, that's where I used to play ball. That's where I learned to play ball. And I also learned to smoke out here in Kensington Park, behind the backstops. When I disappeared for hours at a time, Mom always knew I was a kid.
I sang at a lot of weddings. I had a little white tuxedo that I used to wear. And my mother used to go out in the garden and cut a rose, put it on me when I had a gig. So I was always involved. I sang at all the school functions. And so I was always involved in show business. The 1937 World's Fair in Cleveland, I was featured there. I was 10 years old.
The radio thing was a lot of fun, and my voice kept getting better and better as I got a little older. By that time, I had outgrown the Billy Tilton School of Music. I had an operatic coach, Miss McConnell, I'll never forget. She was a typical opera singer, not that wide. She was a nice lady. I'd come in and do the scales and do different exercises, sing all little operatic things. And only because all this training helped me do what I wanted to do, which was pop music. One day I came in for my lesson and she said, okay, C major scale, la. I went, la, 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 la. She said, what was that?
I don't know.
Wasn't something I ate. I didn't have lunch yet. Say it again, C major scale, la, 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 la. So my mom came to pick me up and she said, I'm sorry, Mrs. Fishman. His career is over. So that was it for the kid singer. So it was concentrate on instrumental music time. I was playing in bands at the time, but I wasn't old enough to drive. So I'd be schlepping those drums all over the neighborhood in a coaster wagon. It was like the Pony Express. I'm schlepping this coaster wagon and I'm being attacked. You have to fight off the guys and get to where you're going. When I went from elementary school to junior high school, I just, boy, does that band sound good. You know, junior high school, it's like music. I work hard at my band work, and I managed to get a ribbon every year for junior high school band. And then an uncle passed away, and he had an alto saxophone. And he said, well, the alto saxophone ought to go to my room. It's funny, I was the only one that had any musical talent, so they said, give that to the dummy. I started fooling around with it and found out how to make it not make a noise. And I was playing it before I ever took a lesson. But all my relatives thought I was wonderful because I could play without even a lesson. I started taking saxophone lessons from a Hungarian guy. Of course, I started out playing Hungarian songs. What else? Hey, Serena, Serena, Huliarta, Lozate, Tsoka. And I started getting into dance music. So when I started with the saxophone, I thought, hey, that's more better. And then when I graduated junior high school and went to high school, then it was, whoa, I just died and went to heaven. That high school band sounded great. Besides, there were some good-looking chicks. Oh, you're not supposed to say chick. That's politically incorrect. There were a lot of good-looking young women in that band. So not only was it a musical experience, it was a social experience. We had a lot of fun. And you got a uniform. Hey, you were in the marching band. Okay. You know something? You know how important that was? I learned to march in marching band. When I got drafted, World War II, and I was in the Army, I was a good marcher. And that started a whole thing about marching until I became a first sergeant. Just from marching around on a muddy football field. Here we are on Coventry Road, Cleveland Heights. This was my house. We lived downstairs, and we had tenants living upstairs. And there was a third floor, servants' quarters. Of course, we didn't have any of those. My father was a painting, paper hanging contractor. He used to figure jobs on Sunday morning. So I'd come downstairs, you know, stumbling downstairs, 11, 12. Sit down at the table with my dad and have coffee. And he'd be reading the paper, drinking the coffee. He'd say, what time did you get home last night? I don't know, 11:30, 12 o'clock. And he'd say, that's an amazing thing, you know that? And of course, it's the middle of winter. He says, you got in 11:30, 12 o'clock last night, and I went out this morning at 9 o'clock to go figure a job, and the motor was still warm. Can you imagine that? How good this car is, that motor stayed warm that long? Oh, well, maybe I got in a little later than that, Pop.
Nobody
saw that inside this boy there was a lost, lonely wildness.
But this was a good house. A lot of happy I'm starting to choke up. A lot of happy memories in this house. I got drafted out of this house. Of all things, the night before I went into the service, report for duty, I was at a rehearsal with my band, playing my horn. We're on our way home. I was with my girlfriend.
Jailbait, the shocking story of boy crazy girl.
And I was going up into the road. Guy pulls up next to me, he's blowing his horn like crazy. What's wrong with him? He shows me a badge and says, pull over. He said, I almost hit him head on. I didn't see him. Says, you know where you're going? You're going right over there. And there was the cop shop right across the street where he stopped me. How convenient. So I went into my macho stance and said, please, officer, I'm going to the army. I may never come back. My girlfriend may never see me. My folks may never see me. I'm going to the army. Tomorrow morning I'm being drafted. Yeah, well, harumph, harumph, humma, humma. Good thing you're going to war, kid. Or that's where you'd be going, right over there. You be careful. I was very careful all the way home. I was careful when I went downtown and took my physical and got drafted.
We all knew when we became of draft age, you know, 17, 18, whatever it was, we were going into service. And in March of 1945, I was drafted. Went in there, the buck private. Time I left, I was a tech sergeant.
Really?
It's a stultifying experience. Stand up on a platform naked.
I'm just embarrassed to death. You don't do that in civilian life. You don't stand naked in front of a panel of guys and a panel of doctors. You're standing there, and there's a big mirror. You can look at yourself and go, whoa, I got a cockeyed shoulder and a funny hip.
I got to this one place, and it's fuzzy-faced PFC. You know, he has your papers. And he looks at me and says, student and musician. What do you want, the paratroopers or submarine duty?
Smart aleck me, I say, he didn't look any much older than I was. I said, well, gee, I don't know. You look like you've been in both of them. Why don't you tell me which one is the best?
And he gave me a salty look and picked up a stamp, rubber stamp, put on a stamp pad one. It said INF. Hey, I made it into the infantry. So that was the start of a long, illustrious military career.
And my orders read to report to Fort Ord, California. All the marching we did was in the sand. It was close enough to the end of the war that we were being trained to hit the beaches in Japan. We were going to invade the Japanese mainland. The war ended. They dropped the bomb while I was home on furlough, and everybody was celebrating. I mean, it was a holiday.
So where did I end up? Korea. Well, I probably was the first contingent to land and do occupation duty in Korea.
Private Marvin Fishman landed at Busan, Korea. And that's what it smelled like. Busan.
We got off and we're lined up on the beach. Everybody's going, what is that? And everybody's looking at the bottom of their shoe. What did we step in here? It was a beautiful country. The hills were all terraced. There was rice everywhere. The awful part of it was that they didn't have a sewage system there. They used to fertilize the crop with human waste. There was no bed of roses. Whew.
And there isn't a paved road in Korea. When we got there, they had a paved nothing. We paved whatever roads that were paved in Korea at that time, we did them. Like the Kimpo Airfield. They built a highway to Kimpo Airfield, which incidentally is where I ended up with my band over there. I had a combo. Kimpo Combo. I was on tenor, and I had a bass man from Cleveland, and a piano man from Cleveland, and a drummer from Chicago. Good group. In fact, we used to have USO groups come over and entertain, and we'd end up backing them a lot of times. And one of the showgirls came up to the band stand one night and said, boy, I never expected to have to travel halfway around the world to find a cafe society outfit like this. And I was very proud of that. We did some interesting things in Korea, like guard duty, and then we unloaded ships. They'd send reefer ships. I was at reefers, they issued them. Reefer ship was short for refrigerated ship. So we continued with our police action, keeping the North Koreans up above the 38th parallel. So there we were in the middle. The North Koreans didn't like us, and the South Koreans didn't like us so much either. My captain,
Gerald W. Reeder. I'll never forget once I was driving him somewhere in a Jeep, and we got stuck behind this ox cart, honey dipper, with two big barrels on it, and the breeze was blowing. That's part of the sewage system in Korea. There's no way I could go around this guy. There were people walking, and the captain was getting madder by the minute. He said, "Get around there! Get around, get around!" I said, "I can't, Captain. I'll wipe out four stores and six pedestrians." That ain't been a yet of them. I dropped it in the second and gunned it. Just at the time he decided to give this Korean driving his honey wagon a smack for not pulling over. So just as I whipped around the corner, he leaned out to hit this guy, which was not a good thing. I wasn't in favor of that. The reach over like this, and I went around the corner, and I got off that turn. I said, "Boy, Captain, that was a Captain. Hello." And I looked back, and there he is. He's lying in the street. So I turned around, went back, picked him up, and he's giving a test. He says, "Son of a gun, no good." I said, "I'm sorry, Captain. I had no idea what you were doing there." And our soldiers did not behave very well in Korea, a lot of them. I used to get into big altercations with them. Most of those Koreans had a bicycle. And some of our esteemed armed forces would lean over the side of the bicycle and smack a Korean, knock him off his bike. And they thought that was real sport. I'd get into more fights. My time came up. My readjustment time came around. That's what they called it. "You're being readjusted to the United States." "Well, I can take that, okay." We went back to the United States on a victory ship. The General Gordon, boy, did that jump around in the water. We got back home, and we just had a ball. We went dancing and drinking and just having a good time. You couldn't spend a dime anywhere. We were in uniform. Nobody would let us spend any money. They bought us dinner. They bought us drinks. We just had a ball. These Vietnam guys that came back, they had it tough because it was not a good war, quote unquote. I wanted to get home. We couldn't get a plane, couldn't get a flight, and there was no prospect of a flight. So we said, heck with it, let's take the train. I tell you one thing that was wonderful. The people along the way, wherever we stopped, they were bringing us oranges and sandwiches and bananas. It was really great. I'm starting to tear up. Jeez, isn't that wild? That was a great time to be a soldier. Hey, let's go, clown. And I'll never forget coming up those steps at the Terminal Tower.
There's Terminal Tower. That's where I came home from overseas. Train pulled in the Terminal Tower. Our war hero, our sonny boy, came home in one piece. The biggest combat I saw was a few bar fights. It was wintertime. Walking up those steps, carrying my duffel bag.
And I looked up, and there's my whole family. My mother, brother, his wife, the whole bunch. There's nothing like coming home from the Army. I laid around the house for, a couple weeks, whatever. Just sucked up civilian life, you know, going here and going there. By that time, things were getting close to enrollment for Ohio State University. So I said, go by, and I went down to Ohio State on the GI Bill.
Once you were out of the Army, you decided to attend college, and the winds of fate blew you to Columbus and Ohio State University, where you would study to become a music teacher.
Right.
With all your clowning around, it's a wonder I ever got to class at all.
Do you recognize that voice, Flippo?
Was it at Les Hosey?
A fellow music student, now the supervisor of performing arts at Fort Hays.
Wait a minute. You dirty rat.
Tell me, did he really keep you from class?
Yes.
How did he keep you from class?
With the one-liners he's using now, and they weren't any better then, they are now.
I thought I was going to be the only one to wear a funny suit.
Well, now, you all have been friends ever since, and as a matter of fact, Les, you even played trumpet in the Bob Marvin Orchestra, is that right?
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, he played good.
Channel 10 comes on air for the first time in Columbus, Ohio as WBNS. The initials stand for How the Wolf Family Attained Their Fortune, Banks, Newspapers, and Shoes. Ohio State sophomore music major Marvin Fishman dons a new name, too, Bob Marvin. It sounded better for the bandstand.
WBNS-TV has always been quick to spot and develop local talent.
Channel 10.
I was at the Neil House Hotel playing saxophone and singing with a band. And some executives heard me sing. And in spite of that, they invited me over for a drink. They said, would you be interested in being on TV? And I said, what's that? Executives from Channel 10 asked me to come down and audition. At that time, I was wearing a mustache and looking very cool. I was a musician, you know. Musicians had mustache. That was before all this face hair became popular. Musicians are always on the cutting edge. So I said, okay, fine, I'll come down and audition. I went down, just sang a couple, three songs. And of course, they had seen me working the stand, the band at the Neil House. To me, it was just another gig, you know, to get through school. And he didn't make any money at that time. I said, okay, you got the job, all you gotta do is shave off that mustache. I figured, why not? See, because every time I went home to Cleveland, my mother would say, ooh, I hate that mustache. I'll give you $50, you shave it off. Oh, okay. Get the $50, come back down to school, let it grow back again. So I shaved it off, and I became a vocalist and funny man on Homemaker's Hobnob. Oh, Mr. Gleba, oh, Mr. Gleba, he had a da 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 da, and we'll dance around the room. Absolutely, Mr. Gleba, positively, Mrs. Shea. Tom Gleba and Gene Shea. We did it every morning. I think it was $1.25. At that time, that was pretty good money. But it was an easy gig, you know, you just picked out songs, wrote out cue cards, you went through all the stuff you memorized. I sang and did comedy. We used to have themes every now and then. This theme was old vaudeville times. And so I was singing a song entitled My Old Tomato. And it went, I want my old tomato, my old tomato, if somebody else can love me like my old tomato can. It was like that, and it only went faster. We held one another's cue cards for one another. Held them up next to the camera so we'd get the words. And we're standing there talking to Pat Wilson, and I'm looking at this, and they're doing the intro to my song. And now here's Bob Marvin, and doing a song for you, right, 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 right. And he's standing there talking to Pat, and they're going, they're into a real heavy conversation. And Walter Nichols, I love my old tomato. And Ray Rhodes standing there going, and so I'm singing, oh, my y'all can love me like my old tomato can. And all of a sudden, I see Ray going, uh-oh, and he zipped over to the camera, holds the cue card up, but I couldn't find my place, you know. I was things like that happen all the time. We were all young, we were all talented, and we didn't know what we were doing. So that really made it great. We were all giving it our best effort anyway. Had no idea the impact of television. The reason we didn't think anything about it was because we had little bitty television sets with round screens, that big. I said, well, man, you know, what's this gonna do? They aren't gonna do any good. It had a crummy looking grainy picture on it. We come a long way from St. Louis, didn't we? That was my start of my television career. They went to a show called Take 10, but they figured they'd milk Homemaker's Hobnob for as long as they could, I don't know, a year, year and a half, two maybe. So they came up with Take 10. And the theme song, I went, take 10, da-da-da-da-da-da, take 10, ba-da-da-da-da-da. And so we changed all the lyrics till it came out, take 10, and throw your set away, take 10. You saw this yesterday. I had to sweat it out. You know, I didn't really care whether I had a television show or not.
Ward Baking Company came along and wanted a clown show. And he said, have you had any experience with makeup? I said, just on Saturday nights, but they cleaned up that part of town. So I was the only idiot on the staff, and so I was the one that got hung with the gig.
If I got the television show, that meant I was cool. It was either that or get a real job.
And I was supposed to audition against a guy that had been in the clown business. I don't know if he was a circus clown or not, but came the night of the audition, and this was supposed to be after sign-off.
You can't audition children at 11 o'clock at night.
This was before the days of tape or even the kinescope were so bad then. And we were supposed to audition a show for the J. Walter Thompson people. They were sitting up in an audition booth upstairs, and they were looking down. And we had been rehearsing all week long. I had been talking to chairs, you know, kindergarten chairs.
You know, we couldn't get kids in for the audition. So I practiced with kindergarten chairs. I interviewed kindergarten chairs. Do you know how nuts you can get talking to a kindergarten chair day after day after day? Hi, Billy, how are you? See, that particular kindergarten chair's name was Billy.
I was getting punched out by that time, and came the night of the audition, and they couldn't find
the guy I was supposed to audition against. They assigned production teams to both of us. And he looked all over and found out he'd gone back to Dayton. He said television made him nervous. Because, you know, when you hold up something for a close-up, you say, hey, kids, how do you like these cakes? You know, the close-up camera's over here. So that bugged him, and he just disappeared. So I was all he had to audition.
It's whether or not they liked you. They liked me. They really liked me. Turns out Ward Baker Company bought the show. So we were on once a week. That was my idea of a job. Work once a week. Of course, we worked our tails off putting a show together. It's what got me started in clowning. I understand something. This was very early in television days. We didn't know. I mean, I have a producer. What does the producer do? Owl bowl. And a director. What does the director do? Well, he sits in the control room and tells the cameras where to go and stuff. And then he comes out and tells me where to go. I fixed him. I did songs and dance, and I learned magic. And then, of course, I learned how to do it right so I could do it wrong. And it wasn't long that I became real good at it. For instance, one night I turned my car into a telephone pole. And then another time I'm walking down the street and I turned into a drugstore.
What about the kids in the studio? You are really dealing now, when you have children present in a television studio, with an uncontrollable situation. You were at the mercy of fate and of whim.
And live.
Live.
Did you find it uncontrollable?
No. We controlled it. We had a big quip there and stuff that we got control with. Of course, we had pages. We had about, 40 or 50, I think, in the peanut gallery. And their parents were taken someplace else.
Yes.
And detained in a viewing room somewhere. And then, you know, naturally they have to go to the bathroom or something during the
ours end. Did, right during
yeah,
the show.
Well, man. We had one go into a pumpkin on our Halloween
was that the,
show.
The famous pumpkin story, I think yeah. Bob Smith told.
Yeah, he
here.
Told, I'm sure he told
well, tell
show.
It again for those who don't recall it.
That was before I was on the show. I think it was in probably 51. Usually if they have to go, the pages take the kids out during a commercial break to the bathroom. But this boy really couldn't wait. And and he pointed to the bathroom. He was pointing directly over the pumpkin that's on the set. So the little boy thought he meant to go over there. So he just went over there and went. You know. So Smith hardly ever breaks up, but when he goes.
Yeah.
And it was funny.
It was the 50s, and there was no color. We were all black and white TV. So my costume was various shades of gray. And I said that I wanted a traditional clown suit. Puffy sleeves, ruffled at each wrist and a ruffle at each ankle. One of those traditional things, big collar. And we had a problem with the hair because I did not want to put on one of those stocking cap things that many clowns use and perch a little hat on top. You know? And I said, why don't we try some hair, you know, some yarn? So it was not real pronounced. And the hat, the clown headpiece, was straight up, looked like a dunce cap. And I didn't like that. So I gave her what we were calling back then in World War II, a 50 mission crush. And they put the headphones over them and it would smash him down. And that's the way it evolved. And we sang songs with the kids, and we'd do jokes, and snappy patter, and birthdays, and interview kids. Now we had real kids. And Paul Yoker was the ringmaster. He'd blow the whistle, close up, and he'd say, it's time for the Tip Top Bandwagon. And then the organist, Roger Garrett, would play. Say, I'm Flippo the Clown. Hello, hello, hello. I wear the crown. King of the circus clowns. That's where I jump around and juggle or whatever. I'm such a clever elf. I even fool myself. I'm Flippo the King of the Clown. Yay! Hi, gang. Flippo here with another afternoon of fun and frivolity. Yay! It was fun. We had a group of kids on the show, and we had a mock-up of it. Like, you know, the three-ring circus. Well, we had one ring. It was a low-budget operation. We had a one-ring circus, and they sat on the ring. And I came around and interviewed them, talking to them. We gave away a mule. It was a contest. It was a joke contest. But we got this little burro. Burro's a small mule.
We gave away a saddle with it, the whole nine yards. I remember we got the burro in, and we didn't know what to do with it, where to keep it. And we went to somebody that had a stable and asked if we could board the burro there. And they said, yeah, don't worry. I said, well, how much will it cost? He said, no, don't worry about it. When the thing was all over, he sent us a bill for several hundred dollars. And the boss called me in, what's this? I said, man, all he said was don't worry about it. So pay the bill, but don't worry about it. I never knew this for a long time until I got older, and it turns out that my grandfather was killed by a Ward Baking Company truck. They had those big, solid tires, you know? And I remember they had holes around the side of them, and they rode like a truck. And it was wintertime or something, and my grandfather got caught up in some kind of slush or something and ended up under the wheels of a Ward Baking Company. Fast forward 50 years, and here I am making a living with the Ward Baking Company. Isn't that weird? That's weird. I never knew my paternal grandfather. And then Ward Baking Company said, well, we've had enough of him. We're going to go in a different direction. It ran for about 18 months, which for a live kids show in a local market is a pretty good run. Station manager called me in and said, sorry about the show. I got to get a real job, huh? Or maybe go back to school and make something of myself. Go back to OSU. But I didn't like beer that well. They had a meeting, evidently, and they decided to put me on the floor crew for that summer. And when the fall season started, we would come on with another show. So they kept me around, and I ended up being the highest paid member of the floor crew ever because they kept me at my same salary. I think they decided Flippo was so strong that if they tamed me loose, somebody else would grab me, and then I would give them a headache, rating-wise. In the fall, we came on with Little Rascal, Our Gang Comedies. Across the board, and they had just brought the Little Rascals out on the market. And that's how it evolved.
I've heard it said that if he ever left town, all the kids would leave with him, like the Pied Piper of Hamelin. We'd like you to meet Flippo, as we know him, out of makeup. Bob Marvin, musician, magician, clown, and band director.
Bob?
Good evening, Ed.
Bob. Oh, you might know it. Thank you very much.
We went from that to the football show.
This show is kind of aimed at the teenagers and little ones, too, and I hope a lot of you adults are out there, too, watching. But this show is aimed at, like, you know, to everybody, but we want to deal with teenagers' problems and everything. But this song is about personality, and I'm sure you'll know that it's very important. Lloyd Price. Was it Lloyd Price, girls? Lloyd Price is a personality. Oh, whoa, boy. Personality, are you ready, men? One, two. Pay attention. It's very important to you, kid. Well, hello, over and over. I try to prove my love to you. Over and over. Baby, what more can I do? Well, over and over. My friends say I'm a fool. How about, over and over. I'll be in love for you, cause you've got a personality, a personality, a personality, a personality, a personality, a personality, and you got a great big heart. So over and over, I'll be good for you. Now over and over, baby, what more can I do? Hey, hey, hey!
It, you know, it really seemed to come from within. And he strikes me as a person that in a way somehow fell into this thing in 1953 or whenever it was, but all of a sudden very quickly realized this is it. You know, I'm really on to something here.
Well, you've got personality, a personality, a personality, a personality, a personality, a personality, and you got the great big heart. Well, over and over, I'll be a fool for you. Well, over and over.
That was very successful. Had good tune in. Lots of kids watched. And I came up with that, love you, keep smiling.
Keep smiling and don't fight.
Goodbye, everybody. See ya. The Boingers. Flippo's Boingers. Everybody thought that was cute and what a nice thing to do. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Whoop, boing.
Hi, gang. I just gave the projectionist, that's a big word for the fella that runs the cartoon machine, the best of my cartoons.
They've been very carefully selected so that you'll get only my finest. We'll have Popeye, Bugs Bunny, Daffy Duck, and all the rest of your favorites. So, let's get on with the show. You ready? A one, a two, a three, a four, five.
What that was a countdown into the cartoon. We had a six-second roll cue. See, it was all filmed then, no tape. We were always looking dumb when we got into the cartoon. I say, okay, let's watch a cartoon. Two, three, four, five, you know, you're standing there. So I said, we got to clean that up. We've got to find some way to count down into the cartoon. So I came up with the boing.
Channel 10.
It was on at 4 to 4:30, half hour each day. And then gradually as we went along, it kept growing. Then it went to an hour. Then from an hour, it went to an hour and a half, and we started doing full-length movies.
Hello, I'm Bob Marvin. For the past 10 years, I've been in the business of entertaining children. And during that time, I've met literally thousands of kids around Central Ohio and loved them all. Recently, CBS has returned to Channel 10, the 4:30 to 5 o'clock half hour. So we at WBNS-TV decided to take advantage of this opportunity to create a new hour and a half show from 4:30 to 6 that will not only maintain the children's loyalty, but will attract the adult audience as well.
He graduated from running Popeye cartoons to running feature films. So that automatically skews up a little bit the age group that's gonna watch the show.
So I'm looking forward to sharing with you a great new season this fall. It may have occurred to you that in a decade of working together, you may not have recognized me as yet. Well, you are probably more familiar with me in the role of
Flippo, the king of the clown. Then it went to 2 hours.
And now, here's Flippo.
All right, class, we're going to call the roll.
Hero.
No. Not like that. I mean the names. Charlie.
Here.
Jimmy.
Here.
Shirley.
Here.
Joe.
Here.
Hank.
Yeah, partner.
Oh, okay, Hank, you can be first. Be sure and see the early show today for the movie called The First Texan. I think it's a Western.
In a lot of cases, people do watch a program for the movie if you have a host. I think in this case, people were watching to see the clown.
I don't think this has ever been on television in the Columbus area before. It's called Hoot Nanny Hoot.
Again?
And I really didn't care. The movie was really secondary. Let's face it, we had a lot of dogs, and there's no question about that. But people watched to see the clown. He was the show. The movie was secondary. And I tell you, one time we even had a Jerry Lewis film on where the film editing department accidentally spliced one segment upside down. I don't know how they did this. I don't even think we got any calls on it because they're not really watching the flick, they're watching the clown.
The movie was not important at all. You did not tune in the early show to see a motion picture.
Hi, I'm Dan Hamill. I was the clown's Norwegian doorstop from 1970 to 1976. You'll ask, what the heck is a Norwegian doorstop? I don't know. Only he has the answer.
My sidekick was Dan Emil, I-M-E-L, and I kept calling him Imel. And he'd come on and he'd say, it's Emil. And I said, with two M's, it's Emil. With one M, it's Imel.
Dan was always a straight man.
I don't know if I can even tell this story, but
give it a shot.
I had a guy I used to work with by the name of Dan Emil. He was always real straight man. Dressed beautifully. He was a fashion plate.
He came from Anderson, Indiana. And I'd make fun of Anderson, Indiana. I said, they don't have a sanitation department. Lady comes in a couple, three times a week, cleans up a little.
And one of the first conversations I had with him was in the dressing room. And he started talking about this, that, and the other. He says, where did you live? I said, oh, Anderson, Indiana. And he says, you call that living?
And he always come on my show and do the previews, you know, what's going on, you know, on Channel 10.
Here's a guy from Anderson, Indiana that had a terrific childhood, right? He had a dog that was so smart that it ran away. Here's Dino!
Clap, I'm not coming on
clap
the
for
line
Dan, clap
the
for Dan, clap for Dan. Clap. Hey! You gotta come on
I
for
am.
Amy. Tell you
how
what.
Are you?
Here.
I'm
there.
Choked up.
Ah, well, that's the way it is when you spend a weekend with family.
It was cold in Anderson, and a lot of snow on the ground. Oh, thank you, Amy. Would you hold that for me?
Sure.
Here, Amy.
People would send me shtick to do on him. It got to be so wild. They said the White River in and Anderson never has any water in him. I said, now here's the guy from Anderson, Indiana, who holds the record for the 100-yard dash down the White River. Here's Imo. And he'd come in and he'd say, how do you know about the White River? And I said, hey, man, I work with Santa Claus. I know everything.
And I had been just giving him a bad time about Anderson, Indiana. That's where he was from. And, the old lines, you know, about a guy plugged in his razor, dimmed all the lights in the city. We didn't have a sanitation department. Lady would come in on Thursday. You know, all these things I used to bring him on with, you know.
Only had one yellow page.
Right. Yeah.
and dying here. Oh, pardon me.
I've worked with you a long time, but you never got this choked up over it, Dan. I want you to know.
I was okay until I came on.
Wonderful working with you.
Oh.
Want me to press the cough switch?
Yeah, I'll do that.
It got to the point where I heard from the Chamber of Commerce
of Anderson, Indiana.
And I said, well, I'm not sure I really ought to talk to you today. And he'd say, what now? I said, well, I have a letter here from the president of the Chamber of Commerce inviting me to Anderson, Indiana, and thanking you for putting Anderson on the map. And anytime I'm in the area, stop by. They want to roll out the red carpet, give me the key to the city.
Show me the town, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it was signed, I don't remember his first name, it was Clarence P. Woschitz.
Yeah, right. I said, here it is, dear Flippo, yada, 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 and read the whole thing. And I said, cordially yours, Daniel P. Woschitz. I pronounce it Woschitz.
Okay.
And I didn't
know W-O-S-C-H-I-T-Z. Okay.
A good German name. I took German in high school, man. I know how to pronounce German names. But I didn't want to say that on the air. So I said, Daniel P.
Woschitz. He said, what? I said, sign it. Clarence P. Woschitz. Let me see that. He takes it away from me and says,
that's not how you pronounce that name. I mean, it was so beautiful. I said, it isn't. He says, no, it's Woschitz.
I said, oh, thanks a lot. And I walked off and left him standing there and think. And you ever see those cartoons where they draw the mouth that goes like this? I actually saw one do that. Went, just like that.
And I'm rolling on the floor. The camera's shaking. The whole studio went to pieces. But I stand back and so, and he just stood there like this. Just anyway, he's a great guy. He's living in Georgia.
Hey, Creighton, you're all dressed up today. You going to be at the show, huh?
Yeah.
Got a clean T-shirt? I hope y'all had a good time while I was gone. Did you have a good time while I was gone?
Okay, I'm going to raise your dollar.
Hey, I see your dollar, and I raise your dollar.
I don't care what you say. 20 minutes of film is too long for a two-hour show.
What are you doing, Rosso?
Hey, Dave, you got the client server you got there?
I don't know. Hey, Rick, did the chicken place send over the prop for the commercial?
Oh, yeah, you bet.
Oh, tremendous. Bobby, did you cut the film?
Cut
the film, that's right.
Oh, I cut that up right away.
Okay, the honeymoon's over. This is it. Now you got to start remembering things again. Hey, remember what?
We didn't expect you back for a couple hours. We sure hope you had a good flight to Columbus.
You got a new shirt.
No?
What happened to the other one? Disintegrate? He put it in the fresh water and went.
Flippo was somebody that, I grew up with him. I grew up in Lithopolis, and I watched him on TV every afternoon. So when I came to work here, it was just like I've met my idol.
Who's on camera? Anybody? Kenny, our galloping gourmet, is still with us. Kenny, I sort of had guessed that maybe by now you'd flabbed yourself into oblivion, but I see you're still there. All the group's here. That's Ted in the control room. Take Ted's mic away, will you? Oh, that's Ted Smith.
It was a big thrill for these kids to actually see this guy they see on the tube all the time, to actually see him in person, maybe shake his hand or get an autographed picture.
He's a doctor, my son the doctor.
Tuning into Channel 10 and seeing this man who looked like a circus clown, but there was nothing circus-like about his behavior.
Hello. I'm John Marcus's mother. My name is Ruth, and I have known the kid from he was born.
And I, as a kid, was not drawn to the fluffy balls and the big red nose, but to what was coming out of his head and his mouth. And it felt very adult to me and slightly dangerous. because he was hosting the afternoon movie.
And Johnny started with him by sending a letter
about my Norwegian uncle who came to visit us in the United States, who we took to McDonald's.
And bought a hamburger and didn't know how to eat it. He had to have a knife and a fork. And he finished the letter. He was probably 7, 8 years old. And he sent it to Flippo. And Flippo read it on TV.
He read it on the air, so that was it. That's all I needed as far as encouragement.
And that was the beginning of the madness of show business for John.
I remember sitting in my living room and screaming for my parents, you know, because this was the first time something I wrote was on TV. And so it was like a big breakthrough for me.
But I know that John was very proud of the fact that Flippo read it on TV. And that was the beginning of the friendship.
I just had to meet him. I just had to just get over there and see what it was like to do live television.
They called the studio. John wanted to come down and see the show in the studio. And they asked me, and I said, sure.
He probably should have never read it because I would have left him alone.
I remember sitting in the waiting room knitting socks.
And I just remember all parts of it. Like, it's the first time I saw a reception desk. It's the first time you had to be checking in with somebody. And then, of course, the thing I remember is sensing Bob being in a room without seeing him.
So he came in and I met him, a nice young man. I forget how old he was, 10 maybe, 11. He was all gung-ho on showbiz and especially television, and he loved Flippo. I put his chair for him right there on the perimeter of the show, and he sat and watched wide-eyed.
Here I was, 12 years old for a live broadcast, and I brought him jokes. And I watched him do his live show, live television.
Mom had to just hang out while I was with him for an hour and a half. So she was always a big supporter of my dream of going into television. So that was the first sacrifice she had to make. But of course, she loved him too.
So she says, thank you for having Johnny here. He's been wanting to come down. I said, hey, you're welcome to come back anytime.
Trips were numerous. Numerous.
I had the bug. Flippo was going to be my ticket into the business, so I kept coming back to visit. And I would stand there while he did the show, and during breaks, we would write jokes together. He let me in to write with him. I felt like I had arrived.
But I remember being very intimidated. I can imagine if I were Flippo and this kid who never said much was saying he wanted to go in TV comedy, I'd be wondering about him myself. He always was kind of very generous and encouraging.
When I realized that Johnny was so serious at such a young age, I realized that after his father preached to him one day at the dinner table, his father is a doctor, and his father preached to him that Johnny and all the other boys, Stanley and Helgi, his brothers, have to be doctors or lawyers or pharmacists or dentists.
He's a doctor, my son, the doctor.
So Dad finished his dinner and left, and Johnny got down from the chair, went on his knees and put his hands like this and said to me, Mommy, please, I want you to promise me that I will never have to be a doctor, a dentist, a pharmacist, or something else. I want to be a writer. And I said, Johnny, I promise. And I kept my promise.
But you did, but you did tell me a hilarious joke. What? I remember it. It's a joke I remember to this day. It went like this. If girls are made of sugar and spice and everything nice, why do they taste like anchovies? I was 12 years old, and I didn't understand it, but it came from Flippo, so I knew it had to be good.
Yeah, right. I never said that.
So the next day, I was at school, and I told it to a girl who started to cry, and then she told it to a teacher, and then she told the teacher who told her the joke. Now, this was back in the days when teachers were allowed to paddle. So, Flippo, that is why whenever I hear your name to this day, I associate it with a giant pain in my ass.
Long after that, we were invited to their home for dinner. And the lady's a terrific cook also.
Our times flew. We saw Flippo we became friends. We saw Flippo very often.
We talked together, Martin and I, and he said, what do you think about this? I said, look, Martin, it's a tough business, but John's got talent. Let him go to school and study, and let him give it a shot.
I believe that my dad probably even offered him a cash reward if I changed my mind.
We drifted apart, you know, you go through some things in your life.
He probably didn't visualize what would happen.
One night they were talking about this new show, The Cosby Show.
First Cosby Show came on the air in 1984.
It was gonna be great, it was just terrific. The pilot looked super and so forth and so on. There came The Cosby Show. So I made sure I was there right at the start to watch the show. So I'm watching The Cosby Show, which was a sensation. Remember when it first came on? It became the style at that time to start rolling credits on the front of the show as well as the back. I guess there are so many credits they didn't want to roll them all in the back. So they roll some of them on some of the opening scenes in the beginning. And they rolled the credit, and it said, written by John Marcus. And I went, whoa! I took the stairs two at a time going upstairs. That was when I could run up the stairs to my desk upstairs in my bedroom. And I went through the Rolodex real quick, and called the Marcus.
The telephone rang. And who is on the phone? Bob Marvin.
The doctor answered, Martin Marcus. And I said, Martin? He said, yes. I said, this is Bob Marvin. He said, oh, hi, Bob. How are you? I said, I'm fine, Martin. I don't want to take up too much time. Are you watching The Cosby Show? He said, yes. I said, is that our John Marcus?
And Martin said, yes.
And I was so excited. Well, it turns out that John Marcus turns out to be one of the bright lights in television.
And I said to myself, what's Cosby doing with a little Jewish boy? What kind of a job did he get?
The bits were the fun parts of the show, interspersed in the commercial breaks.
Hi, partners. Howdy. Nice to see you out there. I was just sitting out here in the backyard thinking. And I was thinking to myself, if I just knew what this next bit was, I'd do it. But I lost it.
There were very few flubs, but the times it did happen, they were good flubs.
I would write them, usually by myself, woodshed them in my office and make them up and steal them out of books and find them in joke books or wherever I could.
You know, Flippo.
Yes, Bobo.
Kids really got it easy today.
Kids, what?
Hold it down. Moses would have seen you, there'd be another commandment.
Bum, bum, bum. Kids are what?
Please laugh. I did when you came in.
They're laughing in New York right now. Go on. Kids got it
what?
Easy today. Kids
Where
got,
are we?
Kids got it easy
I'm
today.
I'm double parked when we were
in. Kids got it easy today.
They do?
Yes.
Yeah, they do.
Sure they do. You had it tough, didn't you?
Oh, boy.
You went to a tough school. Tough school, right?
Oh, tough real tough school.
Sure.
How tough was it?
Jeez.
This isn't going to be worth it. The school was so tough that the only holiday we had was Dillinger's birthday.
Hey! Oh, boy! I like it. That's a good one.
Did I tell you my kid graduated from high school last week?
Terrific. Was she in the top half of her class?
No, but she was in the part that made that half possible. Yeah. One, two, three, four.
I will not cough.
team doctor told me I don't look 30. What do you think about that?
Oh, I don't think you look 30 either, but you used to.
Are you not going out with girls the way you should because of gray hair? Do you look older than your years because of gray hair? Well, then just spray away the gray.
Ah. Look at that.
Terrible.
Right in the old sand there.
Yeah,
right,
certainly was.
One of those Sahara shots.
Yeah.
Well, Caddy, I suppose you've seen worse golfers in your day. I say, Caddy, you've probably seen worse golfers in your day.
Oh, I heard you the first time, sir. I was just trying to remember. Remember! Scalpel? Clamp? Tweezer? Lettuce? Pickle?
Hold the pickle, hold the lettuce. Those kind of orders can't upset us. If we're gonna do this number, do it my way.
Scalpel. We always tailor our bits to be shown to our families. You know, we figured whatever our kids could watch and the adults as well wouldn't be offended by it. We figured that was something we could do for general consumption, for the general public. One of the most embarrassing things I ever did was a little girl was moving from Columbus to Corpus Christi, Texas. And she wrote me a very sad letter that she wasn't going to have Flippo where she went, Corpus Christi, Texas, and that she was going to miss me, and could she please have a picture, et cetera, et cetera. And I told her I'm sure there'd be some dummy on TV in Corpus Christi that she could enjoy. I'm sure they have clowns and funny guys all over, so, you know, drop me a line from Corpus Christi if you get a chance, and I'll answer back. And I finished that, and I said, Corpus Christi, doesn't that sound like a cereal? Like, hey, kids, try Corpus Christi's in your bowl with a little cream and strawberries. You know, just a dumb thing. Boy, I started getting the letters and cards. The Catholic religion is very organized. They got cards. I forget what the colors mean. Red means you did something dumb, and blue means you're all right. Anyway, I got a whole lot of the wrong color cards. And the boss calls me and I said, what did you say? I said, I don't know. And then one of the cards said, I said, tell me about Corpus Christi. Well, I found out that Corpus Christi is Latin and it means the body of Christ. And the dummy here doesn't know that, so I use it as a metaphor for Corpus Christi's in your bowl. And I was really embarrassed. I came on the next day and I did an apology to rival the Gettysburg Address. But I never said that again, except now. Is that okay to do that now? Well, anyway, it was a very bad faux pas, but I didn't know what I was saying.
I did the makeup ritual.
He knew how to time a show. He'd been doing this for years.
In there, you know, in his jockey shorts and bare-chested and, you know, doing the whole deal. And he would tell me a lot about his early life. We would talk, you know, about girlfriends that he'd had growing up in Cleveland, and he gave me a lot of advice. But he would be putting on the makeup, and he'd end up with the final, like, eyeliner, and then do the lips, and we got to the point. It's about 4:25, and the show's going on at 4:30, and
he knew where he was supposed to be, when he was supposed to be. He was there, so I learned quickly. I knew not to expect him any earlier.
In between the cracks in the early show, the movie, the commercials, the bits, the clown always found time for guests passing through Columbus.
Take this opportunity, let me tell you why I'm really here.
Okay.
You know, I ain't never missed but two big events in my life.
Yeah.
They were the birth of my mother and father.
Uh-huh.
But I felt that I missed being on your show, there would have been three, and I didn't want to have to count that high.
Hey, listen, I want to thank you for coming by. I appreciate it. I appreciate that. You put me in there with all them big events.
Well,
I'm the third one.
That's right. No question about it.
And you're going to be in town, what? We just said it, this Saturday.
Yeah, we'll be here Saturday night. Now, I want to invite you out to the game, you and all your friends, because we'll be doing the same show here at the Fairground Coliseum that we're going to do on the moon in 1980.
Is that right?
That's the only place we haven't been, and we feel by then we'll be ready to go.
They got you scheduled, huh?
Yep. Trying to get some lead-weighted shoes so we can offset that force of gravity.
Well, we always knew you cats were far out.
When
Once upon a time, on Walton's Mountain, there was a rock slide. I'm Grandpa. I was under it.
And you got stung.
Mary McTonough is on my left. Hi, Mary.
Hi.
Welcome to the early show.
Oh, thanks.
So nice to have you with us. And over here is Eric Scott.
Hi.
And Eric is really Ben, and Mary is really...
I'm
really Aaron.
And here we are together. Oh, and they got your names on there so they can tell you apart.
That's right.
What's in the middle?
Dummy.
they didn't write it on there. So
I know why you didn't put that on there. You couldn't spell it.
That's right.
Well, welcome to the early show, both of you.
Thank you.
To have you here from Walton's Mountain.
We're happy to be here.
You've been everywhere. Oh, incidentally, Mr. Ortega, the morning man at the W.S. Rainer Station.
Si, senor.
He's said to tell you hello and give you a kiss. Not you. Oh. And said that he enjoyed having you and that you're invited over to his house later on for tortillas and beans.
Oh, gracias, señor.
I'm not invited,
okay. We're glad to have you here. Have you had a busy day? I suppose you have.
Yes, we've had a very good day.
A good
day.
You've had a busy day.
A little early.
That's okay, Eric. It's been a long day. I know, under the lights. Do you want to tell me about it, Mary? It's obviously, Eric's out of it. Huh? Tell me. Okay, now for my next point. I can name that tune in four notes.
Yummy, 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 I got love in my tummy. And
all right, who's the name of that band? You know the name of that band? I don't know the name of that band. I know the name of that band, but that band's standing right here. Hey, Ohio Express, what do you say? Rose, what do you say? You're five. This is the Ohio Express. They're in town. What didn't you notice? They are right here, and I'm blocking this coat. I shouldn't do that, man.
Sorry.
Let's see if it burns into the camera. I wish you the best, and I hope you have lots of groovy records. The Ohio Express is King Tut's Lounge. That's out where? On Morse Road, is that?
That's right, exactly.
Okay. Out on Morse Road, so y'all make it out there for some groovy, groovy sounds, okay? Thank you, man, for coming around.
Thank you.
Sure, enjoy having you here on the band, on the show. Aha! Well, that's an appropriate and fitting number for this gentleman. On my right, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Don Amici. How do you do, Mr. Amici? So glad to have you here. May I call you Don?
You sure may.
It's amazing. Well, you know, the people that walk in, and they're all beginning to gather now. They walk in and they want to see and be near a legend, and that's something that we consider you to be because of the wonderful things you've done in show business. And of course, the one I suppose that you're most remembered for is the story of Alexander Graham Bell.
I suppose I'd probably be right.
Do you ever get tired of talking about that?
No, I don't get tired of talking, but not talking about it. I don't talk about it very much. Other people do.
Other people do. Well, we can't remember because, as I told you earlier, I don't know if these fellows have seen or not, but we suffered with you when you started. And the worst part of it was they stole your patents.
Yes, or they tried to.
They tried to.
Yes.
We finally prevailed in the final analysis.
We finally got it.
I don't really recall. Did you get rich after that or just comfortable?
No, I got very rich.
Very good.
Very rich. Yes.
Well, I hope you hung on to some of it.
Yes, we came away with a nice little bundle.
That's good. We all have a chance to see you. You're at the Country Dinner Playhouse, and there are tickets available, so please call and come and see a wonderful actor and a great guy, Don Amici. Thank you for coming by.
Okay? He's as real and as personable as he seems on TV.
Hold it now, no foolishness here.
It was like you're a little kid again, and you're going out, and you're going to play with your best friend. And you can say what you want and do what you want because it's all in fun.
You said that.
Hi, Ted. I just want you to know that the last time Creighton was here, he looked rather bizarre. He came on wearing a T-shirt and a tie. Mm-hmm. I'm glad you didn't do anything silly this time.
In honor of your return to the show, Flippo, I went out and bought myself a new suit, Uncle Sol's Remnants, $10.50.
I think you overpaid.
But you had to remember that only the clown did the snappers.
Some people have suggested that the pants were a little short, but I thought I'd model them and let you and the viewers...
I think they look nice.
How do you think they look? I'm
glad you didn't do anything silly.
The pants are too short or my legs are too long. I don't know.
No, the hair makes up for it. You kind of don't notice when you kind of get riveted on the page boy.
Right.
And you don't notice the kneecaps.
The crew... They loved him.
Wait a minute. Did you do this whole number with gum in your mouth?
Yeah. Helps me relax.
The crew did like to play little games on the clown, and the clown liked that too. One time I remember in particular, we were running a very wholesome family film. And on the teleprompter, just as he led to the title of the movie, up came the centerfold of some man's magazine, and he lost it. That was one little time when the crew kind of got back at the clown.
Now, he used to pull pranks on our news anchors during the news show, though, because they came on right after he did. He'd go back in his dressing room, take off his suit, leave his underwear on, and his shoes, and walk back out during the newscast with his bathrobe on, get between the cameras while the news anchor was telling a very serious, somber story, and flash him.
Another time, April Fool's Day, we decided to entirely remove the set from the studio. There was nothing in the studio except his hand mic lying on the floor and a lockdown camera. There were no operators, there were no floor directors, there was nobody there. The clown, typically at the last minute, hearing his theme music going, came rushing out in the studio and said,
No cameraman, that ought to improve things. Are we on the air? Is what I'm saying going on the air? Finley, I'm gonna kill you. Anyway.
He was by himself, and I truly don't know if he thought we were going live or not. I think it really got him.
April Fool, ha, ha, ha. Ha, ha, ha. This is better than last year? Yeah, y'all did yourself. And I don't know what next year, I got to remove the building.
People would line up to be able to actually see Flippo the Clown in person. You might shake his hand, you might get an autographed picture, but he's there right in front of you.
It's time for Flippo at the Fair, starring Flippo, the King of the Clown, and yours truly, Dan Immer.
Unbelievable crowds, like no show I've ever done.
Here's Flippo.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Ohio State Fair in Channel 10, Pavilion, Pavilion, Pavilion.
His last show was at the fair during the two-week run at the fair. It was very emotional for the clown. And as it went on, he just got more teary-eyed about this whole thing.
I have mixed emotions. I hated to leave Channel 10. You know, it's like home.
From the Channel 10 Pavilion at the 1977 Ohio State Fair, WBNS-TV and the All-Ohio State Fair Marching Band salute Flippo, the King of the Clown.
Ladies and gentlemen, the greatest television clown in the United States.
We better hurry along, or I'm not going to make it.
We made a special close for him. It was very simple that year at the fair. We took a very nice color slot of him. We ran credits over it, and we used Barbara Streisand's song, Look at That Face.
I have nothing to say except that I love you all, and it's been... See, I can't do this. Well, it's been a long time, and it's been a wonderful time. And I want to thank you all for all the nice things that have happened to me over the past 26 years. That's a long time. And I tell you, everyone wants to know the secret reason that I'm leaving Channel 10. Now I'm going to tell them.
Okay.
I didn't figure it'd be steady. I flip from one job to another. Every 26 years, I change.
It was a very emotional time. I mean, after all, this guy had given all these years.
I'm going to disappear into the woodwork for a while, but I'll be around to see you all again. From the early show, from Channel 10, from the Ohio State Fair, I love you, and bye-bye, I'll see you again.
He got so choked up, he couldn't handle it, and we had to just dissolve away to the close. He walked off the stage. I'd never seen him that choked up.
Look at that face, Jet. Look at that fabulous face of yours. I knew first look I took at it, this was the face that the world.
What was the reason that you left WBNS?
Well, I did it under the influence of money.
Yeah.
I wanna wake up in the city that's
This was something new. This was a new frontier in television, cable, you know. And not only cable, but two-way cable that you could respond to your TV set. And that was, everybody's walking around with their eyes going like this, that you could respond to your TV set. Well, as it turns out, the viewing public didn't think all that much of it.
Time of day! I had a heck of a time getting a cab. Hey everybody, it's me again! Flippo the King of the Clowns, and I'm on Cube. And you're the very first viewers to experience two-way TV on Cube. And that's what Cube is all about.
And that's something that he will always have, that honor of being the first performer on any kind of interactive television. The Warner people wisely decided to hire the most beloved person in that town, Flippo the Clown.
We put together interactive television shows.
Your answer to this question will directly affect the play of the first two-way game of public opinion, How Do You Like Your Eggs?
We just came up with all these stupid shows.
And they could immediately tabulate them in the control room. They knew exactly how many people were tuned in and how many people responded. And, four.
it was not a big audience.
It was a grand experiment. It was very exciting.
It failed because of Flippo, believe me. Never put your career in the hands of a clown. It's, you know, he's, no. Oh, it failed because they didn't know how to keep up with the technology. It was very expensive. It was way before its time. I think it's now just really becoming significantly historic because now interactive television really means something. And here's a guy that understood the comedy, understood a good joke, was a good broadcaster.
I loved it. It was better than working. We worked pretty hard, especially during the early days. I mean, the early days of Channel 10, we worked hard too because we were creating everything. We didn't know what we were doing. Shoot, they just invented television, and we were just doing it. And, no teleprompters, all cue cards. And then when I went with Warner, they didn't know what they were doing either. Experimented around till we got it done. But it was a great time and a great run. I loved it.
Look at those eyes, as wise and as deep as the sea. Look at that nose, it shows what a nose should be.
Everybody's getting up to straighten out their underwear. Thank you. And I guess this will go down as the greatest night of my life. And I will never forget this night. And I won't forget Frank, what's his name? Who put this all together. And, you gotta, when you leave, you always gotta leave people laughing. So this couple was having a 25th anniversary. And the husband says to the wife, honey, we've been married 25 years, and I want to get you something nice. How about a nice diamond ring? And she says, I don't want no diamond ring. He says, well, how about a string of pearls? And she says, I don't want no string of pearls. He says, how about... We go on a cruise. I'll take you on a cruise around the world. And she says, I don't want no cruise around the world either. He says, well, what do you want? And she says, I want a divorce. And he says, a divorce? She says, yeah. He said, well, I wasn't planning on spending that much. Thank you for being here tonight. I love every one of you, and I really love your kids. I've had a good time, and it was beat the hell out of working. Bye, everybody. Good night. Be careful driving home.
We like this live TV thing.
I never expected to live this long.
Oh, come on.
Really? Aren't so many.
Oh, just how far on horse? Your side.
Bye bye. Stand by. Here we go.
How about that little car? Love that little car. A face familiar to thousands of Central Ohio viewers, of course, Flippo the Clown. He was a staple on 10TV for years with plenty of loyal fans. And Flippo himself, Bob Marvin, joins us right now in the 10TV studio. Bob, thanks for joining us. We want to tell everybody that you're going to be honored tonight, one of possibly your final public appearances tonight. We're going to have more about that.
I'm hoping.
You're hoping, huh? You don't want to do any more, right?
It's tough putting that suit on anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But I carry this around with me.
One of your half dozen hats, right?
At least. And I carry this around, and it's always good for a ride on the bus.
Always is.
And as a matter of fact, sometimes it's good for a ride out of town.
What do you miss the most from doing TV?
What I really miss the most is being about 35 years old.
Really?
And I don't recommend, you look good, you got a nice suit on, you're looking sharp. Don't get old.
That's a tough thing, an eventuality, unfortunately, though.
It's highly overrated. And they say, yeah, but it beats the alternative, it's better than the alternative. I said, how do you know? You don't know that. I could be up on a cloud somewhere playing my saxophone with the Glenn Miller Orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
That would be something. And anyway, so I bring this along, and everybody recognizes me. See? And if I ever end up in the gulag, I just turn this around. And I become Russian clown.
That would work.
Okay? That works very good. Russian clown.
It looks very good.
Yes, hey, thank you very much. Good accent, okay?
All right. Hey, Bob, you know, when you all the different things that you did, what was the favorite thing you did on air? Do you have just a special moment that you remember?
The special moments for me, it sounds wild. It was out of the Ohio State Fair. But the thing I miss most were the guests that I had. Red Skelton, all kinds of wonderful people were on my show.
Some of the classic comedians of the time. That we wish you the best.
Thank you. It's a really, really, it's an honor to be, what do you call it, enshrined at the...
At the Historical Society?
I always figured I'd end up in the Hysterical Society.
Mm-hmm. Well, that too.
I end up in my folks always figured I'd end up in some kind of an institution,
mm-hmm.
but they never figured it was going to be the Ohio Historical Institution.
Let's remind everybody about that. Bob is going to be honored at the Ohio Historical Center. This could be your final public appearance. Is that true?
Probably.
Clowns don't fade away. They
just die.
No, I said that backwards. Take it from the top.
Well, what do you mean? Old clowns don't what? What do you want me to say?
Old clowns don't die, they
just laugh it off. I don't know. We're trying to come up with something, a grabber and something trite. And I don't know. Old clowns don't, we all die.
Off comes the makeup. Off comes the clown's disguise. The curtain's fallen. The music softly dies, but I hope you're smiling as you're filing out the door. Cause as they say in this biz, that's all there is. There isn't any more. We've shared a moment, and as the moment ends, I got a funny feeling. We're parting now as friends. You your cheers and laughter will linger after they have torn down these dusty walls. And if I had this to do again, and the evening were new again, I would spend it with you again. But now the curtain falls.
Hey.